You've got a great tradition of family in retail, and yes. Your grandparents and your father. And then you went off to do arts and teaching. Mm-hmm. So firstly, tell me about how sort of growing up in an immigrant family who were in the retail trade and what that was like. And then I've got a question about teaching as well.
Okay. Growing up in a retail family who didn't want to talk about retail was very interesting. My mother forbade discussion about business at any table. So it was never ever discussed, but I used to sneak out with my father on Saturday mornings and go and look at the stores with him. So that was my real introduction. At 11, I was asked to work in a store, and my job was cleaning the toilets and cleaning the dust from underneath the racks. So I started life in retail there, but definitely not at the table, no discussion, absolutely not. And my grandmother started the Sussan business in 1939, and at that time, obviously, goods were very, very difficult to get. Mm-hmm. And she started with a lingerie business, and she was using parachutes to make the lingerie out of.
Silk?
Silk, yep. Absolutely. Mm. So all of her lingerie initially was made out of parachute fabric. And I always used to hear the story about how suppliers used to stand outside the door every day to make sure that they would actually get paid. Mm. So they used to hound her for the money at the end of the day and with the day's takings make sure that they were paid.
Gosh.
So she ran that business and developed three or four stores over the next 10 years. And then my grandfather went into it to assist her. And then my father married my mother in 1950, and that's when he asked if he could go into that business at the same time. My uncle was still a student then, and my father and my uncle developed the Sussan business in the 60s and 70s together. Mm-hmm. And I went, I had absolutely no intention of ever going into the family business. Mm-hmm. As you said, I did an arts degree at one university and then did a dip ed at the right university. And my dip ed was actually very formative to me at New South Wales. I met some very, very exciting people, and I developed a real passion for linguistics and languages. My BA was in languages, French, Spanish and Indonesian, that were my majors. And then going to New South Wales, I met one of my lecturers was a man who was very interested in bliss symbols, which was a communication. It was like a communication tablet. Sometimes you see kids who don't speak using them, where there are symbols for cup, saucer, toilet, drink, whatever. And there was one of my lecturers was very, very interested in that, and I started to get very interested in alternatives to language as a way of communicating. Mm. And I spent the year doing most of my rounds at very interesting schools like Rudolf Steiner schools. I did have one stint at Dover Heights Girls High School, which convinced me totally that I never ever wanted to teach normal children in inverted commas. Because they were not interested in the least in French, Spanish or Indonesian. They just wanted to know about sex and drugs. And I honestly had nothing to be able to offer them in those areas. So it really convinced me, and I was really mentored by this extraordinary man at while I was doing my dip ed, that I could go and work with children who didn't have language skills, that I had an ability to communicate and was very interested in all different types of communication facilities like sign language, mm-hmm. list symbols. So he convinced me that I could potentially work with children as a teacher, children who didn't have language. And that really fed me into looking for a job with children who didn't have language. And when I left New South Wales, I got a job with the Vern Barnett Diagnostic Centre in Frenchs Forest in Sydney. Which was the only private school for autistic and schizophrenic children. Mm. And at that time, they had many of the most difficult cases, and most children didn't have language. So I luckily got a job there as a teacher's aide and worked with some amazing teachers and worked with some fantastic children using those skills. So and that led me onto retail. No, it didn't.
Well, that was my next question. What prompted the shift from teaching into retail? And of course, you did some other things as well. You're in advertising and marketing.
Yeah, I think that nothing prompted the shift into retail. I did a lot of things. I left the Vern Barnett Diagnostic Centre after about 4 years. I moved to back to Melbourne, and then I went into advertising, book publishing, and tried a variety of things. And I think one of the skills that my parents did give me was an ability to think that I could do anything, that there was nothing that I couldn't tackle and couldn't try. So I did try a lot of different things over the next 7 or 8 years, and I really loved all of them, and I really enjoyed all of them. And then in 1989, I got a phone call from my father, and he said, oh, look, we've got some issues here at the business. We'd really like you to have a look at it. And I said, no, absolutely not. Just had another baby, not interested, can't possibly do that. And I've already got a job anyway. So he was extremely persistent and said, no, we really want you to come in and help. You can do it part-time with the other job and manage all of that. And so I landed there in December 89, couldn't resist his charms. And
some leverage at the dinner table, perhaps, after all.
Yeah, yeah, leverage everywhere. And started there in the marketing department.
And then strategic planning was something, another strength of yours too, wasn't it?
Yes. Yeah. When I started in the Sussan business, the Sussan business had gone through some really patchy years in the 80s. Obviously 1981 was when they launched This Goes With That, which was obviously a groundbreaking advertising. And unfortunately, people still say, why don't you use This Goes With That? I do explain to them, you know, it's nearly 30 years old and I think we've gone beyond that, but they still remember it. It's sort of like a bit like Coke. So it was really a very, very difficult time in the late 80s. Interest rates were very high. The Sussan business had been through an extremely difficult time, and there was a very large competitive base at that time. You know, the Katie's was on its own. There were a lot of businesses in that sort of middle market which did the same thing, and Sussan wasn't very differentiated. It sort of lost its way. So when I came in 89, I really thought that the best way to do it was to look at the business from a strategic point of view, because it hadn't been looked at from that point of view before. It was sort of very much a sort of cottage industry then. So we decided to look at the business carefully, and I really went through the sort of people that were in that business, and they were the sort of people that really wanted the business to succeed. In a way, it was a little bit like when I bought Sports Girl in 1999, 10 years later. There were a whole lot of people in that business who just wanted it to work, but just had the wrong leadership. And various other things as well in Sports Girl, because that was really, I bought that out of administration. But the Sussan business had been struggling. We turned it around pretty quickly because the brand was very well known. So the early 90s was probably a very, very strong period for them, when other people weren't doing so well.
What's your strength? Is it big picture detail? Or what makes you, your ability to drive that?
I think there are a few things that really interest me, and the first thing is focus. I think it's very easy to become unfocused, and it's a little bit like what Fred was saying, that people tend to want to look at a lot of different things. It's very hard to keep people very focused on the main game all the time, especially in retail. There's always something that somebody wants to get excited about, whether it's a new chain opening and how are we going to compete with them, or whether it's a new category, can we get into accessories or can we get into sleepwear? Somebody else is doing a job better here, can't we kill them there? There's always a lot of impetus about doing new things, and it's very, very hard to keep people focused. So I think I'm good at staying on the tram tracks. But then, on the other hand, you have to be very good at detail as well in retailing. So it's very important to be able to actually go into a store and recognise what's happening, look at the detail. So I think that I've got a great balance, a really good balance of being able to focus but yet look at the detail.
You're also an innovator in that you've tried some ideas at the head of the competition. So where does that influence come, and where do you get your ideas to innovate?
Well, I get my ideas from everywhere. I look at
gardens, I look at perfumeries, I look at anything that I think is great. I mean, Williams and Sonoma is my favourite store. It sells tea towels and cups and saucers. But it's the way they display it, it's the way they grind the coffee as you're walking in the door, and it just smells beautiful, and you just really want to go out and buy everything that's in the store. So I find lots of things very inspirational. I think one of the things that has been really important to me is that I'm a private company. There's a big difference between a private company and a public company. I'm also, I bought all of the businesses out of the family in 2003, so I'm a sole owner. So it gives me the ability to try things that perhaps in other circumstances I wouldn't be able to try. For instance, both Burke Street and Chadston, both of our stores, are what we call super flagship stores. Some people or many accountants would probably tell me that I've overcapitalised on those stores. But to me, it was an opportunity to really give people a most exciting experience. And both of those stores actually have won international retail interior awards. So we were able to do things differently. We were able to take risks perhaps that other people aren't able to take.
And this is this divide between listed companies with all the exposure and the kind of public pressure on them and what you're describing is that your ability perhaps to take if things aren't going quite so well one year, then you can
don't have to tell anybody my results. So as a private company, I have a lot more flexibility and fluidity.
Mm. Was that when you bought out the business? That's often a big deal in a family business, isn't it? When one, there's a desire to see the generations continue. Very often there's not the passion in members of the family to continue it.
I was very lucky because the family members wanted to go different ways, so it was quite easy for me because I said this is what I want to do, and the others said that's what they want to do. So it made it very easy. I know other families who haven't had it quite that easily. I mean, obviously it wasn't that simple, but it certainly worked out extremely well. It is my passion. I love to do it. I bought both Suzanne Gray and Sports Girl while I was within the family context, so I really felt like they were my babies anyway. So it was a very exciting time for me, but a very difficult time because I took the risk on my own. Some people thought it was very strange.
And did that unnerve you, or were you?
No, it didn't unnerve me at all because I had great confidence in the people who were with me. I had a fantastic team in Suzanne Gray, I had a fantastic team in Sports Girl, and Suzanne, my three CEOs currently are all young, two of them are young women that I've mentored, the other is a woman that I've worked with for 15 years. So I felt very, very confident that the teams and I could actually make it happen. I never worried about it at all.
Well,
the banks might have worried about it.
Yes, well that was the other question.
Yeah, the banks might have, but I didn't.
You need deep pockets to run a private business.
Well, the bank had deep pockets, yeah.
Good relationship with your bank. And your auditor, who is here, by the way.
Yes.
it brings me to this, to what you bring as a leader. But, about 5 years ago now, Naomi did a boss club with us, and she described what she said was the desire for new leadership, which flagged a whole lot of the trends that we're now coming to see, which is the need for greater engagement by people, the need to be more flexible in dealing with your employees and so forth. How do you, tell us more about, and give us some more insights into your approach and actually looking after your staff and motivating what is, in otherwise, you know, it's a pretty boring job for many people.
Oh, I might consider. It's boring at all.
Yeah.
Retailing's fantastic. Yeah. I suppose I started off thinking about how can you work with people and get the best out of them? And what I started to talk to people about was the way I was managing was really by conversation. It sort of evolved. So I don't really have an office and I don't use an office. I spend most of my time walking around and talking to people, involving myself in their conversation and asking them what's important to them. So we developed this whole style of interchange which isn't based on me being their boss, even though I am. It's an interchange which allows us to have free dialogue. We talk about lots of things in a way which perhaps some people would see that as confrontation. I see that as getting the best result. And I tell everybody that I work with that it's very important to me that they do argue with me, that they do have a point of view. I'm much happier when people say that they don't like something or they do like something, and that we get the best outcomes like that, particularly in fashion retailing, where a lot of it is about, is this garment going to sell to our consumer or isn't it going to sell? And I might have a point of view, and somebody else might say, look, I really don't agree with you. And I'm sure that I get the best outcomes because of that. I just love it.
Are they, are the staff confident that they can actually raise those issues with you and disagree with you? And
oh, absolutely. Yep. Don't have any problem with that at all. Yeah. No, and I think the other thing too is that I'm involved in other people's lives of people who work with me. I generally know who their children are, what their children are doing, what their spouse is doing. They know what I'm doing, what my children are doing. Everybody knows my son's doing VCE this year.
Yes, how is that?
It's good. It's my third, so it's okay. It's okay.
It'll be over soon.
Yes. But I really try to involve myself with people's lives when they work with me. I mean, one of the things that we did was we built a new headquarters together. And we talked about the things that they wanted in that building. I mean, we have a huge kitchen. Everybody eats lunch there every day. We sit around, we talk. There were the things that they wanted. I wanted a completely open office. They didn't want a completely open office, so we've got a compromise there. Mm-hmm. I put a garden through the middle of it. Everybody goes out there in summertime and sits there. I really wanted to make an office that people could really feel was almost their home. Most of my staff spend most of their lives working with me. And this was my way of being able to say thank you, involving them in a new environment and creating a work environment which is very different to most you'll ever see.
What can other employers learn from you? Because we hear a lot of lip service paid to this, the kind of things you were talking about, you obviously practice, but it's not done an awful lot in many respects, is it?
No, I think the most important thing at the moment is flexibility. Mm-hmm. I employ 99% women, which means that we have to have a lot of flexibility. Most of the women in the office are working mothers, so not only do they work 9 till 5, they go home to their second job, looking after a partner, husband, family. So flexibility is really at the core of what we do with everything. So we have core business hours, but we have a lot of flexibility around that. So some people have 6 weeks holiday, some people work 4 days a week, some people start work at 10, finish at 4, some people have 8 weeks holiday. It really depends on how we can best work and best suit their needs as a group of people.
That takes a lot of managing though, doesn't it? Would you agree it's hard work to ensure the jobs get done?
It does take a lot of management, but we have a fantastic head of HR who's highly committed to making it work, and I have 3 CEOs who are committed to making it work, and all of them are women, and 2 of them have children, young children. So, in fact, my CEO of one business at the moment has just had her second baby at 45, and she's working 2 days a week as the CEO of one of those companies, with everybody in the team working around her and supporting her.
It's a good time at this point to bring up the issue of gender participation. You've got 99% women in your workforce, but there's been a lot of discussion recently about the lack of women at senior levels in corporate Australia. What, and it looks like you might need a reverse gender balance in a way.
Yeah, I never get a problem from the equal opportunity.
Well, I'm just wondering how would some blokes be if they tried to come and work at Sussan?
We don't have many blokes toilets. We have lots of girl toilets with proper mirrors and things like that.
Yeah, Sex Discrimination Commissioner might be coming after you in a time down the track. But yeah. I'll just raise that because one of the solutions to the gender issue is to actually have a 40% gender neutral requirement on boards. And I've got to be careful about the federal government because we're still in this caretaker mode, but that's one of the suggestions of the Labor Party. That would mean 40% men.
I just don't agree with quotas. Mm-hmm. I just don't think it's right. I think it's got to be the right person for the right job. Mm-hmm. I don't agree with that at all.
Okay. What are your thoughts on how we could get better participation by women at the most senior levels in Australia?
I honestly believe it comes down to flexibility. Mm-hmm. I think that women don't have one job. Most women have two or three. And people talk to me about, how do you get work-life balance? I don't get work-life balance, I get work-family balance. There's no me time in that, but I get work-family balance. Mm. And I just think you really have to work hard for that.
Mm. We'll come back to this in just a touch, but I wanted to ask now about how you run your business. You've got the Sussans, Sussan mm-hmm. Gray and then Sussan and then Sports School, mm-hmm. and you're all running under one business. But how do you manage to maintain the brand differentiation and not confuse the brands?
It's very clear to me, mm-hmm. and it's very clear to everybody in their own individual mm-hmm. businesses what those businesses stand for. We've never had any confusion with what does each one stand for because we have very, very clear brand mandates. Mm-hmm. on each one of them. I'm the only one, other than the back room mm-hmm. of finance, wages, IT, etc., I'm the only one who looks over the three brands from a brand point of view, product, mm-hmm. marketing, store design, all of those issues. So I'm the only person.
Sorry, go on.
Yeah.
How would you sum up how would you describe the three, the difference?
Well, Sports Girl starts at the 16 to 24 if you use an age, and it's got a whole lot of emotional stuff around it, which is very, very different to the Sussan brand, which is probably, we call her the Forever 30 woman.
There's a lot of us around.
And then Sussan Gray is a sort of 40 plus, very utilitarian clothing, very low fashion content, very high volume, very restricted price points. So they're very, very clear. I say I go from birth to death. And really, the Sussan and Sports Girl business are very highly differentiated. Mm. Sussan is probably the only company that I've ever, ever seen in a specialty environment that actually has sleepwear and apparel in the same space. And Sports Girl is quite a unique business for its dominance of accessories, mm-hmm. so the entire package. Because most people have accessories, but rarely do they include shoes. So Sports Girl's got quite a strong differentiator in that mix mm-hmm. as well. So that we work on this differentiation. I mean, it's exactly what Fred said. We work on this differentiation mm-hmm. issue all the time. How are we different? And that probably brings the next question to, then how are you going to deal with the internationals who are coming mm-hmm. in to Australia? How are you going to keep differentiating yourself from those?
Yeah, I did have that on my list of questions, by the way.
There's been a lot of noise about Gap and Zara coming into the market.
The fast fashion, well, they call it, don't they, in Europe with Zara.
But yeah. Well, Gap's a denim company that's been around for a long time. And Gap opened today in Chadston, actually, and Peter Pagonis, the Deloitte partner here, told me that his wife was already there and thinks it looks terrific, so that's really good. We're very strongly differentiated and we will maintain that differentiation and work much harder with new entrants as well. Mm. But differentiating your brand from other people is really the key.
Mm. What impact will that have on the retail sector in Australia, do you think? Because there seems to be a fairly concerted effort now from the likes of Zara and Gap.
Well, I'm not sure there'll be a concerted effort. I think that they will have CBD and large regional mm-hmm. shopping centre stores. I don't believe that they'll get to the size of people like us where we've got 150, 200 stores. I think it'll be great for the market. I think mm-hmm. it'll add another dimension to the market. It'll lift the bar in other places. I think it'll be fantastic. I mean, we've never shied away from competitive environments. The thing that's most interesting to me at the moment is not international retailers coming in, it's the internet.
Ah.
And how people are buying off the internet. I had a meeting yesterday with UBS and one of the girls said to me, oh, well, what do you think about this business or that business? What do you think about Target? And I said, oh, I used to buy my kids' wear there. And she said, well, I've got a four-year-old and a two-year-old. I've never, ever been into a shop. I buy all of their clothes on the internet. All of their clothes. So the internet is really, really gaining momentum. So for us as a fashion business, that becomes a really difficult issue because at the moment in London, they're selling winter garments. We're selling summer garments. But if I walk into my office at any time, particularly in the sports girl arena, all of the winter garments that we've seen on the catwalk or that we're looking at on websites, all of those girls will be wearing it. So they're not waiting till next January or February when we're going to deliver them. They're actually wanting to wear the hot boot now and the hot sweater now. So I think that there's a bigger risk in that and a bigger challenge in learning how to manage that than international people coming here.
How are you countering that or working on countering that for your group?
Well, we're not working on countering it. We're trying to get with the program. We've got websites in each one of our businesses. The Sports Girl website is the number one website. We're getting 9 to 12 million hits a month on that website. It's the number one website for young women in Australia. So we're developing that website. We don't look at it as if, oh, well, it's got to be an Australian website. It's a global website because we are taking orders from overseas, Northern Hemisphere customers. But we are looking at the challenge of if there's a hot item now in Europe, how do we make that happen in our stores now, particularly for that very high fashion girl in Sports Girl who's looking to us for that. And first, fashion is very important to us.
So there's so much that subsequent to that that's going to be affected too. There's the whole retail land footprint and the shopping centres and so forth. So to what degree, how serious a threat is that?
I don't see the internet as a threat. I see it as another distribution channel.
Okay.
So the experience is completely different in a store and the face-to-face interaction is completely different. But the internet is certainly a very challenging and interesting space that we're going to have to be very, very aware of.
In the last 18 months, we've had the global frock crisis, which is what I called it, in the retail sector. But we had the
frock
financial
crisis,
frock crisis, and profits and revenues suffered, and the retail sector was fairly squeezed. How's that looking now? Are things starting to uptick?
I think things are very variable, and they're variable by state as well, and they have been for the last. I mean, New South Wales has been a very difficult state for much longer than the GFC.
Now, doesn't that tell you something?
From many points of view. So by state has been very variable. So Queensland and WA have had their boom, mining booms. New South Wales has had its doldrums. Victoria's been quite static. South Australia and Tasmania, well, won't comment. But it's still very variable. There's many days. This week has been unbelievably difficult, and we think it's election nervousness, post-election nervousness. Retail businesses are a great barometer of what's actually happening. September 11, the Sussan customer didn't shop for a week after September 11. The Sussan Grey customer didn't shop for 2 weeks. But the Sports Girl customer was out there shopping within 2 days. But they're great barometers of what's happening. But it is very variable. I don't see, some of the results that are coming out now from public companies, yes, they're a bit better, but I wouldn't say that they've got any consistency about them. I don't share anybody's enthusiasm for a great Christmas. necessarily. It will depend what happens with the political environment, interest rates, very sensitive to interest rates. So I'm not, it's still very variable. I don't think we're out of the woods yet.
We're going to start to come to questions very soon, but just to finish off on this, there's been a lot of talk about deep changes in consumer habits, prompted initially by the global financial crisis and then something else going on. Is that your experience?
Well, as far as clothing, women's apparel is concerned, it's very low down on the disposable income spend anyway, and it keeps going lower and lower and lower. We're just very fortunate that women are emotionally tied to shopping. That's why I've never ever bought or owned a menswear business, because men aren't attached emotionally to shopping. They don't get a buzz out of it, whereas women do. But certainly, people are more aware of value. People are looking for better value. People are looking for versatility, flexibility in their garments. One of the interesting things for us has been that we've noticed over the last 12 months is our ratio of tops to bottoms is very different. So it tells us, I know it's really silly, isn't it?
Well, it's fascinating.
It tells us that women are buying more top of body because they can wear the same black pant. So it changes the way you look at your what you purchase. But they're definitely, if you said, in the old days, the ratio of tops to bottoms was 2.7 tops to one bottom. It's now perhaps 4 tops to one bottom. So people are going out, spending money on what people can see, but not spending money on what people can't see.
Well, I've got the black pants
Me
on
too.
Just to reinforce that. There we go, walking examples of that. And this is just one question that's been quite common in some of the research, which is how, in your organisation, how do you balance the benefits of sort of economic benefits of sourcing product from low-cost manufacturing countries with the both your survival of your business, but also the sort of awareness of environmental impacts and societal impacts these days?
Wow, that's a big one. Mm. We've been dealing with China now for decades, and we have very, very strict rules about the factories we use. We do audits with every factory. So we've been very conscious of that for a very long time. When we used to be able to manufacture in Australia, obviously we could do that locally as well, still have the same auditing procedures and everything like that. I mean, it's getting a lot harder. Supply management is becoming one of the single biggest issues now, particularly with the urbanisation of China. So we're in a situation now where there are less and less Chinese going back into factories, more and more moving into cities, more and more factories closing down. And with the GFC supposedly over in the US and Europe, the manufacturing is getting to some really big numbers in China again. So the factories are becoming overloaded. In the last 3 or 4 months, we've had more late deliveries, more wrong garments than we've ever had in my 20 years of retailing. There's a lot of pressure in China at the moment. All of our raw material prices have gone up. So China isn't coping with what's happening, and their urbanisation is making much, much harder.
So where do you look as the next manufacturing point, if that's not...
Well, we've always been looking at a variety of places. Yeah. So we already manufacture in Indonesia, in India, Vietnam, Bangladesh. We're now looking to Turkey and places like that in Europe, which before were being used by Europeans because they had quota into China, but they don't have quota anymore.
Oh, okay. Now, if you'd like a question, I've got plenty here. Pop your hand up. There's a microphone. Wait for the microphone. And if you could say your name and organisation and keep your question.
My name is Jo Verity. I work in public transport, which has nothing to do with retail. But what I'm interested in is how you move people between the brands, because I can associate with each of the stores you're talking about. Mm-hmm. Haven't shopped in them all, but when I was a student, I thought Suzanne was something to which I would aspire, but couldn't afford it. And then, of course, suddenly you can afford much more than that. How do you halt people in that point where they can afford it and keep them in your brand?
Good question.
I have to say I don't look at it like keeping them in my brand. I look at a brand as a defined set of circumstances. So the Sports Girl brand, if it's doing its job, is attracting the 16 to 24 customer with a certain amount of money, with a certain amount of a way of thinking, the way she wants to shop, the way she wants to relate to the staff, the way she listens to music, the way she talks to her friends, the way she goes to festivals, the way... It's not about... I don't think about it in terms of keeping a customer. I think it's my expectation that the brand delivers to a customer and therefore keeps her. I don't think about it the other way around. In the Sussan business, obviously, sleepwear for us is a major differentiator and a very important part of our business. Not financially important, but important in terms of what differentiates us. So we have an extraordinarily loyal following in that side of the business, whether they're 15 or 70. So I don't think about losing a customer in that either. The biggest issue for Sussan has been being able to maintain its relevance in a contemporary market and moving it along the continuum of fashionability without scaring people away because of what it was. But I think about it from the other point of view all the time. I think about what does the consumer want for me to inspire her, attract her. I don't think about keeping the old Sussan customer or keeping the old Sports Girl customer. I'm continually thinking about how I'm generating excitement and energy and the right garments and the right place for those people to go to. It's more about the attitude rather than sort of keeping them locked in.
There's a question here and then we'll come to the front. That's okay?
Hello, Naomi. Ross McDonald from Google.
Hi.
You obviously are aware of the threat from overseas players and the top shots and so on. I'm interested to know how you're using, from a communication point of view, online to actually bring people to the store footprint that you currently have. More clothes are always going to be sold in store than online.
Sure.
So how do you use online to get people through the front door of the Chelsea store?
I think we're using... The campaigns that we put in store, we're using the same ones online all the time. I think one of the things we've learned about online is they actually want more exclusivity online. They actually don't want to go into a store and see it. They want to have more exclusivity. So we're actually trying to build the online business the other way around, not so much bringing people into the stores that way. I mean, we see the cross-pollination there all the time, obviously. But we are trying to build our business and we're trying to learn more about our consumer through our online business. So we're trying it the other way around. Does that answer?
There's a question here, then we'll go over there.
Hi, Naomi. Barbara Wilby. A couple of questions, if I may. First of all, have you thought about upmarket versus you sort of go from, you said, birth to death?
Yeah.
I wonder if you've thought about upmarket because... Personal observation, I think there's a gap in the market in Australia for 40 plus women's clothing that's, you know, slightly upmarket. Other questions?
You don't think your department stores deliver that?
No, because their service is terrible. And I look for
service.
But
that's a different issue, yeah.
Yeah. Yes, it is. The other issue is acquisition. You've clearly shown your ability to take on businesses that are moribund and breathe life into them. I can think of a couple of...
Oh, I'd love some more.
Right.
Bring them on.
Okay. Is that seriously on the agenda for you? I mean, how are you going to grow?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, good question.
So your second question first, or your first question. I don't think, again, it's about focus. I don't think I'm good at what I would say would be luxury or upmarket. I think Australia's very difficult from that point of view. There definitely is a space there. You know, the 40-plus woman. But there's too many options out there already that supposedly do that. I mean, I would say, you know, if you wanted casual clothing and you didn't have a hang-up about thinking that Sussan wasn't aspirational enough for you, I would say that you could dress in an aspirational way at Sussan very comfortably in from a casual point of view. Some people would say Sportscraft is an aspirational brand. I just think that there are lots of things out there. I don't think that I don't think there's room in Australia for another one. And the department stores should be doing that job for you. They're not for various reasons, obviously. Service is a really big issue there, whereas specialty, obviously service is very, very important to us, and I think that specialty delivers that service element. But no, I've never been interested in doing that. The second question, acquisitions. Yes, I would love some more. And I do believe I've got a team that are very skilled at turning businesses around. And yes, we're looking at things all the time.
Mm. Asset,
if you know of any, ring me.
Well, I was about to ask, asset prices, some of the prices going for those businesses still a bit high, are you thinking, or is it just...
No, there's nothing that interests me at the moment.
Right.
I haven't been brought anything that really interests me.
Keep an eye.
Not menswear.
Yeah. I don't know. I know some blokes who are emotional about this.
Yeah, but there's only some blokes. It's not enough of them.
That's right. Question over here. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Jay from PwC, and I just have a personal question about your philanthropy exploitation and what you're actually doing at the moment. We talked a little bit about how you're on the board of the Howard Florey Institute. Mm-hmm. What are you doing now, and have you got some tips or ideas about what prompts you about who you want to support and how you want to support them and what that gives to you personally?
Yes, I mean, we have a variety of ways in which we support the community. Each of the businesses has their own philanthropic partner, chosen by the staff. Sussan works with Breast Cancer Network. Sports Girl works with the Butterfly Foundation for Eating Disorders, and Sussan Gray works against domestic violence, White Ribbon. Each of those businesses chose that. The people in the businesses, in the stores, actually chose to work with those. And we've done workplace giving for, I think, ever since it was introduced. So each of our businesses have a strong connection, and it's not about giving money. We work with them. They do their conferences in our offices. We do strategic workshops with them. We photocopy for them if they need it. So we offer a range of services with those three. With the Butterfly Foundation, we actually just completed a small wing at Westmead Hospital for eating disorders in Sydney. So we're working with those partnerships very closely, and all of the people in each of those businesses do participate. From my own personal point of view, I work with in areas that I'm very passionate about and believe that I can give my utmost and really make a difference in them. I work with contemporary art because that is a passion of mine. I've worked with the Howard Florey because brain research is a passion of mine as well. And so I pick things that are my passion, because that's where I think I can give my best.
What is it about art that fires you up, that excites you, and it's so much a part of your life now?
It is. I just think contemporary art's very, very exciting. It really inspires me when I can see a film or a piece of video art or a painting or a drawing, which is just so inspiring. It's like somebody who loves to read books. They love the smell of books. It's just something inside you which makes it very, very exciting for you.
So in fact, on some of the brochures that you have for your new staff, you have a couple of lines, which is light, air, sun plus views equals a healthy space. Mm-hmm. And human happiness is a business asset. So it seems, and you also have lectures for your staff as well in art. So
yeah.
Why, I mean, this is there's a bit of a productivity element here, but this is more than that by the sounds of it. Why?
Those words were taken from a booklet that I made when we moved into our new business headquarters. They were part of my brief to the architect because I wanted to create a space where everybody had a view. We're sort of landlocked between the Yarra River, a railway line, the freeway, and a very urban environment. Mm. So I wanted to create a garden in that environment so everybody could look at green. Mm. I wanted to create a very light environment so everybody could have a view and an aspect. Part of that building, well, throughout that building is my private art collection. And it's so much part of what I do. I wanted to share it with my staff so that they could be inspired as I'm inspired, and that they could understand that going to work every day has more to offer than just going to work, that they could be inspired about things, that they could come to an ACCA opening, that they could see art. So I decided to start some lectures at work as well, where I invited the artist whose work I have around the building to come and talk to people about their art. But that's not the only thing we do there. We do have lectures about every 6 weeks. I've also invited David Maloof to come and talk, so literary people. I have artists, I have makeup people. I mean, I have any sort of creative disciplines that I think people would be interested in. And we also have everybody from breast cancer, domestic violence, so we have quite a range of lectures through the year.
It prompted a journalist to wonder whether you were an enlightened boss or a control freak, telling your staff how they might live as well as work.
Well, I'm a bit of both, actually.
When does the control freak come out?
I guess this is mixed company, but I guess the control freak comes from some things that I just actually don't believe should be touched. And when I bought Sports Girl, I had numerous letters from people who thought, this is what you should do, that's what you should do, this is what you should do, that's what... But the most amount of letters I had were from people who said to me, the logo. The logo's old, it's dated, the colours are wrong, the script is wrong, everything is wrong about the logo. So my epitaph now reads, don't fuck with my logo. And so I guess that that's where I'm the biggest control freak, because people always, or people try and fix things that have nothing to do with what's wrong. It's very important to keep the integrity of what's right, but change the things that really are wrong. And there was nothing wrong with the Sports Girl logo. The business, unfortunately, had been driven into administration. But it was all about the other things that were wrong. The product was wrong, the space was wrong, the rents were wrong, everything else was wrong. It wasn't about the logo, and people are always so tempted to change those. So I'm a bit of a serious control freak when it comes to that.
And when you, are you an enlightened boss? When you go around the stores and drop in and see them?
No, I think I'm enlightened when I'm trying to share my passions. I think by having artists, in the office, it shows people that there are other creative people who can inspire them, and I think that's very important. So I really think that's an aspect where it's exciting for them and really shows them a different way of looking at things.
Now, your Australia Day Honours Award mentioned the importance of mentoring, and this is something we know you do quietly, but how do you go about that, and how does that work? How is it effective?
Well, there are obviously different spheres for mentoring. I have mentored a lot of women that I am very quiet about, but the ones that I'm probably most closely connected to are the two young women who both run, one runs Sussan and one runs Sports Girl. Both of those women have been with me for more than 10 years. And it's a gradual introduction all the time. It's talking to them. It goes back to the whole management by conversation. It's completely the antithesis of authoritarian way of doing things. So it's really my conversation with them all the time and showing them what to do. I suppose that's where it comes, where you say big picture versus the detail. So I'm very involved in the detail within that mentoring and can sit on the top and through the detail with them, so helping them.
Mm. What we'll pick up a couple more questions, but there was a really good question here from there were a number of good questions, but this particular one from Leonie Walsh from Productive Management Solutions. Is there one standout role or an experience in your career and life that has made the biggest contribution to your success?
I definitely think that my sports girl and turning around that business was the single most important thing I did, because it gave me so much courage to do other things. It gave me the ability to look at things in a completely different way. When you buy a business that's completely broken, I mean, it was really completely broken, and when you build that business again, it shows you that you can do things, that there are people who are committed to it, that you can work with, that you can actually get things done. And so it gave me an enormous amount of courage to do things that I would never have tried, and allowed me to do that across the brands.
Mm-hmm. So what's been the biggest lesson, if you had to share the biggest
Don't
lesson
fuck
of your
my
career?
Logo.
aside from that.
Well, the biggest lesson really from that experience was when we were doing the due diligence, there were 120 people throughout that sports graph, David Lawrence, LEB, all of those businesses, and Sports Girl. And we did all of our economic modelling on 62 people. So within those 4 days of due diligence, we actually had to choose 62 people. And I would say most of those people are still with me now. They're amazing people who just believed in the brand so much and wanted it to work so much. Their prior problems were nothing to do with them, and believing in those people just gave the brand complete meaning straight away. So that probably was the single most important thing.
How do you make a judgment on people and their capacity in a short time?
You trust your instinct.
And that works?
Yeah,
in that instance, obviously.
In that instance, it did.
Yeah. Does it ever not work?
Yeah, often.
It's pretty dicey. We have some more questions? Okay, there's one at the back and then we'll come to...
Hi Naomi, Kylie Sheriff from Westpac. I'm a little bit like you, Kelly. I like your philosophy on the logo, and I wish that my previous employer, ANZ, had spent a lot less time and money on their logo and a lot more time and money on their conversations, which would have been nice. But my question, putting on the banker hat, relates to succession planning, which is a big problem for a lot of businesses, but particularly private businesses. Mm-hmm. What does your succession plan look like? Are you grooming those kids at the dinner table and having those conversations now, or does the for sale board go up?
No, absolutely not. Whilst I am a private company, we do run our business like a public company. I have three CEOs, and if I'm hit by a bus tomorrow, they know exactly what they've got to do. I'm not planning that for the moment. I sort of not planning my retirement. I remember when I bought the businesses from the family, people said to me, oh, well, what's your exit strategy? And I said, well, I just got here. Why would I have an exit strategy? They said, oh, well, you must, because you're going to have a huge private business. So what's your exit strategy? Certainly I'm not planning on an exit strategy, but I have always run the business so that there are people who can run it. I would have no doubt that the three women who run those three businesses could run it very effectively as they do now, whether I'm there or not. I haven't thought about, oh, well, then do they get sold, et cetera, et cetera. But certainly in terms of taking my responsibilities very seriously, which I do, my job is to protect 4,500 people. So if anything were to happen to me, my major concern is that those businesses could run and that those 4,500 people out there will have successful jobs to continue with. I certainly haven't thought about family options. And I suppose having gone through, sort of buying the family business, it's not something that I particularly would want my children to go through as well. So, you know, there were some lessons in there that I'm not sure I want them to go through. Luckily, they're not there yet.
Okay. All right, thank you.
That was a good question. one here, and I'm just realising time's galloping away, so we'll have to wrap up very soon. Yes.
Sorry, hi, Carla Boynton, BHP Billiton. For women looking to join boards in the future, do you have any recommendations or suggestions for women looking to join boards in the future?
Commercial boards. I'm much more interested in women joining the not-for-profit sector. But do I have any advice for women wanting to join public company boards?
There's a lot of momentum behind that at the moment to try to increase the very low numbers.
I would actually be interested in your thoughts on either. I personally have found it difficult to find people or the right people to be speaking to actually join boards, whether it's not-for-profit or commercial, so I'd be interested in your thoughts on either.
Well, I think not-for-profits are quite easy to find people for that. I mean, I think you have to find people who are passionate about the area in a not-for-profit sector. Joining other boards, I personally think the nexus of the old boy, and I don't mean old men, old boy as in old men, are just the same old faces on public boards. I think there needs to be a nexus. I don't think a real break in how boards are developed and chosen. I don't, you know, there are a certain group of headhunters who are always looking for board members. I think that has to be broken down. I think, you know, people have to be brave enough to look at other ways of getting board members. But, you know, there is a network which feeds off a network, which I think has to be broken first. I don't know whether you share that view.
I think it's a really good point. Okay, well, we've got time for one more question, then we really have to wrap up, otherwise they'll haul me off the stage. I think it was just here yesterday.
No, a lot of pressure. Fiona Moylan from Westfield. I think you have a few shots with us.
I do.
Yeah. Lightening the mood. I've got so many questions, and
that's not unusual for Westfield.
I'm not in leasing. I work in digital, and
doesn't matter.
And
give me something here in the online world.
So I'm not going to make this business related because I obviously know about your business. I think what's particularly interesting, and I find it very interesting the way you bought the family business. We're trying to sell the family farm at the moment, and It's hell. I can only imagine what it was like with the family business. But my question is this. You have so much on your plate in business and outside of work, and you've got kids and you've got a husband.
He's in Sydney, though.
Okay. All right. What do you do with the pressure? Like, I'm trying to find a hobby at the moment. I'm walking stereotype. But what do you do to manage the pressure you feel? Because even listening to you, I find it's palpable. Like, I don't know if I could handle that kind of pressure. What do you do just to Naomi time, just to relax?
My best Naomi time is with my kids.
Yep.
I have to say. But I have to say my conversations with my CEOs are my Naomi time as well. We're very close, and I use that as a way. I mean, we're not friends, but we are very close, and we do obviously share the business interests together, which is a major, obviously, very, very major part of my life. So, you know, I probably speak to each one of those people at least twice a day. So that's my time for expressing my frustration, what I want to share with them. The Naomi time, you know, I love what I do. I mean, I couldn't do what I do if I didn't love it. I'm absolutely breathing, eating, sleeping it all the time. I just love it, and I don't find it a burden at all. Most people say, oh, well, why don't you find that a burden? But I don't. I just love it. So I don't think about Naomi time like that. I mean, Naomi time for me is going to Chadston and seeing the new Gap. That's fantastic. So I don't find all of that pressure. I mean, my most precious time is with my children, but I don't worry about the Naomi time as being, you know, the normal sort of thing.
That sounds like a pretty good note to switch off on, I think. Would you please thank Naomi Milgrom?